Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Always We Begin Again, Stepping into the Next New Moment by Leeana Tankersley. Narrated by Carla Mercer-Meyer. Publisher's note. In this audiobook, you will hear writing prompts. Please take the opportunity to jot down your thoughts and answers as you listen along. Introduction. You make the path. I'll show up and take care of you as I promised and bring you back home. Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11. At my church, there is a stained glass in the front center of the sanctuary. I look at it every Sunday as it rises up behind the pastor's head. The stained glass is two figures, an angel and a person. The angel is holding the person and they are looking out to the horizon together. The person with her hand above her eyes, as if straining to look out and see. Most of us are looking for the path, some kind of clarity. And it's practically impossible to see at times, no matter how hard we look, how hard we strain for answers. It's just not yet materializing exactly. The most recent season of my life has been marked with significant endings and beginnings. I've been navigating the end of my marriage, which was not my desire. As a result, my three kids and I have moved across the country from bustling San Diego to a quiet town in central Virginia, which has been nourishing and also very new. And now we wait for more to be revealed. What happens when the path is just entirely unclear? What do we do when we cannot see much of anything at all? Where is the path exactly? Where is the person or people I thought would be with me on the journey? Who will accompany me going forward? When will they arrive? Where are we headed, if you had to say? What am I supposed to bring with me? What am I supposed to leave behind? I get into a fit about every third day over these questions. I recently heard these beautiful lines by Spanish poet Antonio Machado. Pathmaker, there is no path. You make the path by walking. By walking, you make the path. I find such great comfort in these words. The path appears as we walk, one step at a time. By walking, we make the path. We step into the very next, new moment, and then the next, and then the next. We begin again, despite all odds. The path does not arise or clarify because we run faster, think harder, or work more efficiently. The path arises and clarifies one grace-filled, love-filled, faith-filled step at a time. This is how we will make the entire journey. And so we will need courage, strength, peace, resolve, patience, faith, grace for ourselves and for others, all the things we do not naturally come by on our own. In other words, we will need reminders of who we are and who God is. I've collected some of the reminders I return to over and over again, the truths that have sustained me. Here they are, a collection of daily readings that I hope will companion you as you step into each new moment on your particular path. You'll read about new normals and messy middles and soul bullies and come-aparts. You'll read about the wall and the soul voice and warrior sisters and being brazen. Somewhere in the midst of it all, I believe you will find what God has for you. And, like the image in the stained glass, you will remember that even in our greatest uncertainties, we are held. It's all held. May every word whisper to you. There is always a hand reaching toward you. There is always grace available. And there is always a chance to begin again. Love upon love, Leeana. Day 1. The Sacredness of Beginnings. Make me brave. Lead me into the enormous space of becoming. Sue Monk Kidd. 10 years ago, I was a brand new mother to boy and girl twins, and everything felt enormous. My love was enormous. My fear was enormous. My self-contempt was enormous. My exhaustion, enormous. The pile of empty Diet Coke cans, enormous. The baby's beauty, enormous. The weight of how perfect it all was, just waiting for me to mess it up, enormous. I could not cut a path through the extraordinary landscape. It was all just huge. And so I felt nailed to the couch, floating in love and entirely anxious, like I wanted to crawl out of my own skin. Of course, you have no idea what I'm talking about whatsoever. It was in these very early days of motherhood that I read the line from The Rule of Saint Benedict, which transformed into not just a line, but a lifeline, and has been with me every day since those winter days over a decade ago. Always we begin again. Benedict's rule for monks called out the holiness of repetition, even the spiritual efficacy of it. Though our culture preaches only the opposite, it gave a certain grace to beginnings, because that's all those days were, one beginning after another. And let's be honest, that's what so much of life is, learning how and learning how again, over and over. Each day is brand new, after all. We've never lived this day before. It is certainly difficult to not get impatient, even contemptuous with ourselves over our utter novices in life. And the difficulty of being new and inexperienced tempts us to become experts, or in some cases pretend we are experts long before we actually are. Beginning again is permission to be unaccomplished, to be a beginner, to be brand new. More than permission to, a sense that we are right where we should be and that the beginning space is actually a holy space, not just a layover on our way to something better. We can fall into the false belief that being a beginner is being a failure. Are you starting out at something and your newness is causing you to doubt yourself, tempting you to believe you are inadequate? Write out the new thing or things you are navigating. God, give me grace with myself as I tolerate being a beginner. Amen. Day 2. To open up. Anyone or anything that does not bring you alive is too small for you. David White. It was late spring and the breeze brought up the jasmine from the gate where it climbs. I walked through the house, room by room, opening doors and windows, letting air move through the house. Every opened window, every opened door, a prayer. Come in. Help. Thank you. I opened the entire house, cranked windows wide open, found stools and baskets to prop the doors, and then I stood in the very center of our house. I tilted my chin up slightly, and I closed my eyes and let the air move across my face. Sometimes a house feels tight, no matter how many square feet it is. Sometimes a heart and a life feel tight. Sometimes a marriage feels tight. Sometimes our work or our calling feels tight. Sometimes the skin we're in feels tight. We need a door or a window to open, a fresh breeze of perspective. The movement of change, but we don't always know how to get there from here. Opening life up when things feel tight is a vulnerable move. Keeping everything sealed feels so much safer. What will we find when we open the door? What will slide in through the screen? What is waiting for us behind the windows? When this tightness arrives, for any reason, my initial response is to lock, seal, slam, secure, bolt. I shut out. I don't want my imperfections to be witnessed. I don't think I can tolerate that kind of exposure. I do this as a means of self-protection. I do this as a way to control my image as someone who is special. I avoided until I could no longer avoid anymore. And that's when the gentle voice whispered in my ear like it had so many times before, Leeana, always we begin again. The word begin has unique origins. In fact, there aren't many other words like it. In its etymology, one of the meanings of begin is to open up. When we need to begin, often what keeps us from beginning is our desire to shut down or slam shut in the precise place where we need to open up. We feel cornered, shamed, stuck. And so our natural tendency is to go inward. But God is always patiently reaching toward us, and all we really have to do is reach back. But this requires us to open up. Opening up is vulnerable. Letting others in, letting air and space and light in, letting truth in, feels like we're inviting exposure. And I guess we are. But usually, uncovering and opening is what it's going to take to get us out of the corner we're in. I know it feels counterintuitive to let the light shine on something we'd prefer to keep hidden, to reach out when we'd rather turn in, to actually believe that the truth, however scary, will be what sets us free. Can we trust that opening up has more gifts than staying shut, hiding, defending? Is there a place in your life where you are slammed shut? A relationship, a fear, an issue of faith? A place where you cannot let God in, cannot let others in? Is God inviting you to open up? Remember, there is always a hand reaching toward you. There is always grace available. There is always a chance to begin again. Imagine yourself holding on to something, hovered over it, protecting it, but it's all you can see. You cannot see the world, the beauty, the possibility beyond you because you are focused on what you're holding. Imagine God is reaching toward you, asking you to open up, let him see what you are holding. What is God saying to you? What do you say back to God? Day 3. Hear, God. I have held many things in my hands, and I have lost them all. But whatever I have placed in God's hands, that I still possess. Martin Luther. I always thought of surrendering as giving up, but I spent some time with the word over the last year, and as I looked into the etymology of surrender, I found that one of the meanings is to give back. When things aren't working in our lives, a relationship, a plan, a dream, a desire, one of the most important things we can do is surrender it. And it's the hardest. As long as we have our grubby mitts on the person or the pursuit, that's where it will stay, in our hands. But when we surrender our deepest needs and longings to God, we don't give up, we give them back to him. We say, here, God, you can do so much more with this than I can. I'm squeezing the life out of this person or this plan, and I need you to take it from me and do what you will with it. I'm giving it back to you. This is how we move forward instead of staying stuck. If you're in a closed, frustrating loop of behavior or thinking, say a prayer of surrender to God, giving back the thing you desperately want to clutch onto, and then do it again and again and again, 100 times in one day if you have to. God, I surrender this dream. God, I surrender this longing. God, I surrender this goal. Infuse it with your love and grace. I trust you entirely. What is one thing in your life you need to surrender to God in prayer? Here, God, I'm finally giving you. Day 4. Tending. True to your word, you let me catch my breath and send me in the right direction. Psalm 23, verse 3. When we're locked up, anxious, overwhelmed, restless, it's so difficult to do the small acts of each day. At least it is for me. Washing my face, watering the plants, folding laundry, chopping veggies for dinner, all feel impossible. I want shortcuts, and I want to be done with things once and for all. Tending, the act of giving attention to someone or something, is an ongoing endeavor. Tending requires us to begin again and again by its very nature. Because it requires participation and even discipline, tending is good for us. It teaches us to reinvest, to get our hands back into our own lives, to care for something small or menial as an act of love and health. If you are swirling today, trying to figure out what big step you need to take next in your life, try to start small instead. Tend to something. Drink water, take a walk, pull weeds or cut dead branches off your tree, fold a load of laundry, chop veggies, stir soup. Pay attention to your hands as they move. Tending helps tether us to today. It makes us slow down and participate in the menial and the mundane. When I am hustling and striving and trying to hold things together, tending is one of the last things on my list because it requires me to let the moment fall open, and I feel I just don't have the strength to let that happen. Tend. Attend. Be in attendance. Present and accounted for. As I bring my worries and fears and control to God and give them back to Him, tending feels more possible. And more than that, I feel drawn by the soul voice to the raised bed in the yard, the brush and my daughter Lane's wild mane, the prep for the chimichurri sauce, the potted bougainvillea. The voice in my soul invites me to the lemon tree, to tie my turquoise tennis shoes and walk the rolling hills, to read just one selection from the poetry anthology. This is just unreal, if you ask me, because tending does not yield accomplishment. It's just a practice. Is there something you feel drawn to tending right now? Today, I want to take care of. Day 5. Held, no matter what. Christ with me, Christ before me, Christ behind me, Christ in me, Christ beneath me, Christ above me, Christ on my right, Christ on my left. St. Patrick. Do you know that no matter what, you are held? Mysteriously and benevolently, you are held. Your job is to give in to this heldness instead of trying to squirm away so you can go prove how worthy you are. You are held for no other reason than love. Wild, right? I love these words from Exodus chapter 14, verse 14. The Lord will fight for you. You need only to be still. New International Version. But sometimes being right where we are is the hardest work. Sometimes it takes more energy and discipline to be still than to spring into frantic action. That's why it's so important for us to meditate on the truth that God's got us. He's holding things together that we couldn't possibly fix or control. He's conspiring on our behalf. I know it's never easy to let go and fall back into God's love. But that's what we've got to do. God is beside, before, behind, and beneath us. We sink back into God's great love and provision, and we choose rest instead of relentless trying. Thank you, God, that it's never all up to me. Please help me be still today, to sink back into your love and embrace. Amen. If I can sit in this truth that I am held by love no matter what, I can and will begin again. This is what you are to take with you today. No big plan, just the simple yet profound knowledge of your heldness. No matter what, God is holding you. He says, you do not need to do more, fix yourself, or hold anything together. You just need to fall back into my grace, trade your trying for trust. Where you are broken and bruised is exactly the place, not in spite of that place, that I want to show you you're beautiful. Imagine yourself, your life, your circumstances, all held by benevolent hands. What does it feel like to let go, fall back, let down? What scares you? What relieves you? God, it's hard for me to be still because... Day 6. Led by listening. But God wasn't to be found in the wind after the wind and earthquake. But God wasn't in the earthquake and after the earthquake fire. But God wasn't in the fire. And after the fire, a gentle and quiet whisper. 1 Kings chapter 19, verse 12. I don't need to tell you that the world is a noisy place. And if you're anything like me, your mind and your body are also noisy places to inhabit, sometimes pulling you in so many different directions that you end up paralyzed. Noise fragments. It distracts and numbs, making us unable to hear God's voice or even our own soul voices. And to some extent, noise is unavoidable. So we have to find ways to counterbalance the disintegrating distractions that are all around us. For me, the practice of listening has helped me cut through all the competing messages and turn my ear to my own thoughts and feelings, as well as the still small whisper of love. Listening is a discipline. The root of the word listen means to honor, and you have to make time to honor something in your life. But here's all it takes. Carve out 5 to 10 minutes and find a quiet space. Right at the top of a piece of paper, God, what do you want to say to me today? And then listen. If interrupting thoughts break in, like your grocery list or a phone call you need to make, no problem. Dedicate a box at the top right of your paper for anything you need to jot down that's unrelated to your listening. Write down what you hear from God. Write down what you want to say back to Him. Questions, concerns, frustrations, gratitude, anything. Just sit and listen to Him and to yourself and record your dialogue. It's okay if it goes poorly at first. It's okay if you feel distracted or annoyed or frantic or itchy. All of these things are likely. Just keep your butt in the chair. Listening is something you never regret. I recently heard acoustic ecologist Gordon Hempton say, I think that's true. And with more voices than ever bombarding us, vying for our attention and soul space, we could just as easily grab for a solution in the den. That would be quicker. Ingest some information. But I think most of us know deep down that the noise is not where we will find our guidance. We are led by listening. Listening is about trading our trying for trust. This is how we find true rest, I believe. Listening is a begin again kind of ritual. It's never finished, and it's always possible, and it's waiting to give us living and breathing gifts that are new every morning. God, what do you want to say to me today? Day 7. Believe, don't bully. It's as if there's a part of you that so rails against being shattered by love that you shatter yourself first. Janine Roth. Sure, you can get results by punishment, shaming, bullying. Of course you can. That's why these tactics are used in homes, workplaces, teams, and the schoolyard. You can manipulate people using force, but that doesn't mean you will ultimately produce transformation. We often approach ourselves with the belief that if we can just punish, bully, belittle, or deprive ourselves enough, we will ultimately get the results we are after. But I am starting to think we make lasting changes in our lives when we believe we deserve more. We believe we are capable of something greater. We believe we were made for wholeness. We decide to protect the God image inside us. Yes, you can push and prod yourself into action, but I promise you it will not last. You will be living out of scarcity instead of abundance, and abundance, spaciousness, is where you will thrive. Is there an area of your life where you are trying to bully yourself into action or results? Instead of focusing on how bad you are, how much you've failed, Focus on the reasons why you deserve to pursue health and wholeness in your life. Focus on your values, your gifts you want to give the world, your dignity as a human being, and the image of God in you. How are you bullying yourself, either through thoughts, self-talk, or actions? Make a list. God, who do you say I am? You are. Day 8. Every wall is a door. We'll know we've been raised from the dead when everything becomes a door. Every brick wall. Every dead end. Father Francis Dorff. Somewhere in your life, you are experiencing a wall. You have done everything in your power to change this, read all the advice, tried all the strategies, pooled all the collective wisdom, and here you are at the wall. Maybe the wall is an ending, a failure, a nothing is ever going to change situation, burnout, an illness, a rejection. For many of us, we experience the wall when all our normal ways of coping just aren't delivering anymore. Our strategies, denial, numbing, aren't producing, aren't keeping us going like they once did. And we no longer have the strength or stamina or even desire to push through. When we hit the wall, we can do a number of things. We can act like it's not happening, denial, and bang our heads against it or walk away as if the hard thing isn't even there. We can go sideways, destruction, and blow up our lives. This happens regularly. The pain and the tension of the wall cause us to just lose it. Or we can see the entire wall hitting as something completely different, a grace. Could the wall possibly be a door leading to something sacred? Some kind of new life, transformation, revelation, truth, freedom that you could never have experienced without the wall? And could you open that door and see what God might have for you on the other side? Are you hitting a wall of some kind? Name the wall. How might the wall be a door? And what might the door be leading you to or toward? Day 9. Burn it down. I want to unfold. Let no place in me hold itself closed. For where I am closed, I am false. Rainier Maria Rilke. What are you serving that is no longer serving you? That's a question I've been considering lately. What's something in my life that I am overcommitted to, pouring energy into, that isn't offering me anything productive in return? We assume that some of our habits or strategies are keeping us safe, insulated, happy, when really they are secretly keeping us silenced and small. Recently, a phrase kept echoing through me, like a persistent whisper. It was this: burn it down. I had no idea what that phrase meant or why it was coming to me, but I committed to listening. And as I paid attention, I realized that I would hear "burn it down" whenever I was trying to please someone else or win them over, whenever I was trying to cover over someone else's bad behavior, whenever I was trying to keep the peace at all costs. Burn it down, Leeana. Burn it down. I was truly invested in patterns and behaviors that were doing nothing for me. I thought they were helping, but they were only ultimately hurting. I am learning that it's okay to let go of false promises of safety and security, even though it's so dang hard. We cannot hold on to all our old ways and trust God for new life at the same time. Is there something God is inviting you to burn down? A behavior, a pattern, a way of thinking, a way of being in your relationships? What is the cost to burning it down? God, help me burn down my... Day 10. Acknowledge the agitation. The purpose of life is not to maintain personal comfort. It's to grow the soul. Christina Baldwin. Usually, the agitation in our lives is trying to tell us something. Or rather, God is trying to tell us something through the agitation. I believe, even though I don't really like it, that the invitation is in the agitation. If you want to discern the work God wants you to do in your life, look at the tension. I know, this is the last place we want to look. We want to ignore the rub. It feels dumb, if not dangerous, to turn toward it. If I don't look that way, maybe it will all just go away. But I've found in my own life this agitation typically doesn't go away. We just get better at numbing it. I saw a counselor last year, and she told me that every time I felt overcome by obsessive thoughts, it meant there was something I needed to grieve. The anxious loops of thinking were a cue that I had not grieved something important. So instead of getting frustrated with myself when I couldn't control my thoughts, I would remind myself that the agitation was an invitation to ask myself, what do I need to grieve? It was hard work, but slowly, over time, the anxious, obsessive messages began to be less intense, and when they did flare up, I knew how to sit with myself instead of run for the hills. Certainly, we cannot sit in a state of agitation at all times. But take some time today or this week and purposefully turn toward a place of discomfort, tension, or friction in your life. Be sure you are in a safe place as you do this. Where is there conflict you do not want to acknowledge? Where is there a sense of incongruence you want to ignore? You don't have to solve anything, fix anything, or get a plan together. Simply tell God you are willing to look at these tight spaces. You are willing to acknowledge they exist. You are willing to let Him speak to you. What part of yourself or your story do you need to honor instead of ignore? God, what are you trying to tell me through this agitation? Day 11. Love is a battle cry. Watch what God does, and then you do it, like children who learn proper behavior from their parents. Mostly what God does is love you. Keep company with Him and learn a life of love. Observe how Christ loved us. His love was not cautious, but extravagant. He didn't love in order to get something from us, but to give everything of Himself to us. Love like that. Ephesians chapter 5, verses 1 through 2. When it comes to our transformation, God's wrath is not the fuel. God's love is the fuel. God is not a divine bully. He is a nurturing, protective mother and father. God so loved the world that He sent us a way out of our own closed loops of striving and trying. He sent us a new way. His grace. All of it was motivated by love. Love propels us. Love moves us. Love changes us. Love opens us up. Love offers hope. Love carries us. Love coaxes us into the next moment. Love is what helps us begin again. The greatest of these is love, Scripture says. This isn't a nice sentiment. This is a battle cry. Love can do things that judgment and punishment never could. Read these words about love from 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Love never gives up. Love cares more for others than for self. Love doesn't want what it doesn't have. Love doesn't strut, doesn't have a swelled head, doesn't force itself on others, isn't always me first, doesn't fly off the handle, doesn't keep score of the sins of others, doesn't revel when others grovel, takes pleasure in the flowering of truth, puts up with anything, trusts God always, always looks for the best, never looks back, but keeps going to the end. Love never dies. The passage describes God's perfect love for you. Which line stands out to you as the kind of love you need and desire? Day 12. Pull up a chair. With an eye made quiet, we see into the life of things. William Wordsworth. Sit down at the table and pull up an empty chair right next to you. Invite the part of yourself that is scared, stuck, agitated, restless, perhaps young, embarrassed, obsessive, hyper-controlling, whatever part of you is feeling unwieldy, to sit down next to you. Sit her down and listen to what she has to say. Ignoring her only makes her yell louder. She needs attention. She needs to be tended to. That's what she's trying to tell you. So let her talk. Stay with yourself. I know you want to run away from every vulnerable part of you. I know you want to silence the cry, reject the indecision, ignore the fear. But stay with yourself. The very best you can, be where your feet are. Stop running and stay. Imperfectly, impatiently, impossibly, because she needs you. What words does she have for you? What experiences, fears, feelings does she need you to hear? Write them down for her if needed. Be as gentle as possible with her, like you would a hurting friend or a crying child or a wounded puppy. Listen. Tell her that you love her and that you understand why she's feeling what she's feeling. Of course, you might say. Of course you feel that way. And then gently and firmly remind her that she is loved, cherished, and welcomed, but she will not get to be in charge. The youngest, most fragile parts of you cannot make the adult decisions, cannot call all the shots. What I've found is that the more you tend to her, the calmer and quieter she becomes. And conversely, the more you reject her, ignore her, shame her, the louder she becomes. So anytime you feel that unwieldy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.